cervical spineful ophthalmoplegia retrospective study of etiology and prognosis. Dr. Padmavati Maharajan. Okay. Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. My topic for today is painful ophthalmoplegia, a retrospective analysis of etiology and prognosis. Defined as periorbital or hemicranial pain plus any combination of ipsilateral oculomotor nerve palsies, oculosympathetic paralysis, or sensory loss in the distribution of ophthalmic and occasionally the maxillary divisions of the trigeminal nerve, this clinical condition has some very extensive etiologies like neoplastic, vascular, inflammation, infectious, and others. We carried out this study with the purpose of understanding the clinical and etiological profile of the patient to evaluate the neuroimaging findings and to study the outcome based on various etiologies. A retrospective observational study was conducted in Arvind Eye Hospital spanning a period of 2 years and including 27 patients. All cases diagnosed with painful ophthalmoplegia were included, the exclusion criteria being chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia, myasthenia gravis, isolated cranial nerve palsies, and ophthalmoplegia due to other restrictive causes. The demographic data, clinical and neurological profiles, neuroimaging findings, and the treatment outcomes of the patient was evaluated. Coming on to the results, the mean age group of our study population was 52 years, and we found inflammation as the most common etiology. Males were more commonly affected than females, and in both the genders, inflammation was the common etiology. Pain, diplopia, headache, ptosis, and defective vision were the most common chief complaints of our presenting population. Neuroimaging was the main diagnostic modality, and the diagnostic yield of neuroimaging was 96.26%. Orbital epic syndrome and pseudotumor were the most common findings. Coming to the discussion, the most common etiology was inflammation, and the patient was started on tapering dosages of steroids and antibiotics. The mean duration of improvement was around 33 days. The improvement noted in terms of etiological diagnosis revealed inflammation having around 70% improvement. Traumatic and compressive etiologies were very poorly affected. Relative afferent pupillary defect, color vision, and central fields suggestive of optic nerve dysfunction also showed more than 70% improvement. Thus, painful ophthalmoplegia, though a condition with a lot of sinister etiologies and fatal consequences, can have more than satisfactory visual outcomes if detected early and treated promptly. Thank you.
Are you a ratified AOS member?
No, sir.
No. Thank you. The next case, cost management and visual outcome in patients with the atypical optic neuritis. Dr. Sunita.
Good morning, one and all. This is myself, Dr. Lynette Antony. I'll be talking on the causes, management, and visual outcome in patients with atypical optic neuritis. Typical optic neuritis is characterized by acute, painful loss of vision, which has a good visual recovery, and it is often associated with multiple sclerosis. Atypical optic neuritis is less common, has poorer visual outcome, and is associated with other systemic disorders. So it is important to consider alternative etiologies in such cases, investigate accordingly, and institute more specific therapies. The aim of the study which we conducted was to describe the causes, management, and visual outcome of patients presenting with atypical optic neuritis. There is retrospective analysis of patients presented to our center with atypical features of optic neuritis between January 2015 and March 2018 was conducted. The atypical signs and symptoms of optic neuritis which we looked for were age more than 50 years or less than 12 years of age. There was sudden visual loss. There was progressive visual loss for more than 2 weeks or absence of recovery even after more 3 weeks of onset. There was severe bilateral visual loss to no perception of light. There was no pain, clinical systemic symptoms suggestive of other diseases other than multiple sclerosis, severe optic disc edema or optic disc or peripapillary hemorrhages, marked uveitis or retinal periphlebitis, optic atrophy without history of optic neuritis or multiple sclerosis, deterioration even after the withdrawal of the steroids. 11 patients with an average age of 34 years of age was included in the study. 3 were males and 8 were females out of the total. The causes which we came to a conclusion were the post-infectious cases were 3, which were either viral or cat scratch disease. 2 were under the cause of neuromyelitis optica. The other causes which had one patient each was ITP, SLE, pancytopenia, toxic, postpartum or idiopathic. Trial of steroids were given. 6 patients responded to steroids. 4 patients were steroid dependent and 4 patients were given immunosuppressants. Patients with the post-infectious neuroretinitis were treated with a course of doxycycline as well. When we came to the visual outcomes, there was a mild loss after the treatment in 5 patients. There was a moderate loss in 2 patients and severe loss in 4 patients, out of which 2 patients had bilateral severe loss of vision. Presenting one case, a 28-year-old male presented with bilateral blurring of vision since 3 days. There was a history of fever with rash 2 weeks ago. He was treated with antibiotics and his visual complaints were resolved. The right eye vision was 6x24 and left eye was counting fingers at 1 meter. Color vision was abnormal and pupils were ill-sustained in both the eyes. Fundus showed bilateral severe disc edema, retinal edema along the infrotemporal and superotemporal arcade. He was treated with IV methylprednisolone for 3 days and doxycycline, and resolution of the disc edema and retinal edema was seen. This is the OCT showing the resolution of the retinal edema. In conclusion, I would like to say that atypical optic neuritis has a poorer visual outcome. Post-viral neuroretinitis has better prognosis. Atypical presentation should prompt high index of suspicion and prolonged steroid therapy or immunosuppressive may be required.
All these patients, did you rule out tuberculosis also, all these patients?
Yes, sir. Okay. The patients were under treated under neurology. And all the tuberculosis was ruled out.
Was the cat scratch disease confirmed by Bartonellosis?
No, sir. They were suspecting cat scratch disease.
Thank you. The next speaker, role of ocular Doppler in Takayasu arthritis. Dr. Pratiksha Sharma. The next speaker, 8.5 syndrome caused by brainstem infarct, a case report. Dr. Sandhya.
Good morning, one and all. I'm Dr. Sandhya Hegde, and I'll be presenting an interesting case, 8.5 syndrome caused by a brainstem infarct. We'll start. Okay, I'm sorry, the presentation is a bit different. We had this patient, a 45-year-old male, who was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes about 5 years back, but with a variable control. And he got admitted with severe headache, dizziness, mild right upper limb paresis with diplopia about 10 days back. He was admitted for a cerebrovascular accident, got treated and improved with all the symptoms. He came back to us 10 days later with complaints of inability to close the left eye and persistent watering. He had a deviation of the angle of the mouth to the opposite side. Systemic examination, he was conscious, cooperative, well-oriented when he presented to us. The general system and general and systemic examination was nearly normal. The ocular examination showed classical limitation of adduction in both the eyes. There was a limitation of abduction on the left side with some amount of ataxic nystagmus, which is present on abduction to the right side. Primary position, he was orthotropic. There was some amount of broptosis which was noticed. Visual acuity was normal in both the eyes. The intraocular pressure, anterior segment was completely normal except for features of lower motor neuron facial palsy on the left side. The investigations, the clinical diagnosis which we came to was the seventh nerve along with 1.5 syndrome on the left side. His MRI, which was already done, revealed multiple infarcts on the left-sided dorsomedian, paramedian area of the dorsal pons. The fundus examination also revealed low-risk PDR changes in both the eyes. Coming to the discussion, the horizontal gaze is governed at the level of the frontal cortex. From the right-sided frontal cortex, the frontopontine fibers go on to the cross at the level of pons to reach the left-sided paramedian PPRF or the parapontine reticular formation. From there, it goes to the same-sided abducens nucleus and through the medial longitudinal fasciculus of the opposite side goes to the third nerve nucleus of the left side, which allows for gaze towards the right itself. So, INO is where there is a lesion within the MLF and it affects only the adduction on the same side along with some amount of ataxic nystagmus which is noted to the opposite side. A lesion in the PPRF or the horizontal gaze center at the pons would cause ipsilateral gaze palsy on the same side. 1.5 syndrome is where both the MLF on one side along with the PPRF on one side are affected. Sometimes the facial nerve, which goes along the abducens nucleus, gets affected along with these two lesions. And that's why we have the seventh nerve getting involved on the same side, causing an element facial palsy. All these together were coined as an 8.5 syndrome by Eggenberger. The etiologies is very classically vascular in patients with systemic diseases, whereas when seen in younger individuals, it is diagnostic of multiple sclerosis, a demyelinating condition. Very rarely, other inflammatory tumors can present with similar features, and usually they have a good prognosis. So over a period of time, they tend to improve. From the ophthalmic point of view, we just need to manage the facial nerve palsy. The INO and everything does need systemic control. So thank you. It was just an interesting case that we could see. Thanks.
Thank you. The next week's a rare presentation of multiple cranial nerve palsy in a case of multiple myeloma. Dr. Priya Rajasekharan.
Good morning, everyone. My topic is our presentation of multiple cranial nerve palsy in a case of multiple myeloma. A 47-year-old male patient came to hospital with history of left eye defective vision for past 1 month, which was gradual in onset, progressive and painless. History of binocular diplopia for past 1 month with horizontal separation of images, more on left case. History of left eye deviation noted by the family members 1 month back. Past history, he is not a known case of any systemic conditions and he was not on any regular medications. Family history was not significant, and general physical examination showed a moderately built, well-nourished person, and he was anemic, no cyanosis, ictus, and lymphadenopathy was noted. On ocular examination, he showed a left face turn of 15 degree, and right eye findings were within normal limits. In left eye, the visual acuity was 6/36, improving to 6/18, and on a Hitchcock corneal reflex test, left eye showed 15 degree esotropia. Anterior finding, anti-segment findings of left eye showed clear cornea with reduced sensation, and pupil was dilated and fixed. Other findings were within normal limits. Ocular movements in right eye was normal, and left eye showed limited abduction on levoversion and minimal limitation of elevation and depression, and limited depression on adduction. IOP was normal in both eyes, and clinically, second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth cranial nerves were found to be involved. We refer the patient for neuroimaging. MRI brain and orbit showed a large hyperintense mass in sphenoid sinus extending superiorly to compress the optic nerve and posteriorly compressing the brain stem with extension into the left cavernous sinus with involvement of left, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth cranial nerves. This other image showing sphenoidal lesion, and that is a CT MRI showing multiple distinctive punched out lesions replacing most part of the vertebral column, skull vault, right side of the ramus of mandible, zygoma, and sphenoid body. And further blood investigation showed hypochromic microcytic anemia, and on electroporosis, there was increase in lambda light chain with normal kappa lambda ratio. And a diagnosis of lambda light chain multiple myeloma with intracranial plasmacytoma was made. A discussion, in India, the median age of onset for multiple myeloma is 55 years. Multiple myeloma presenting with neurological symptom is very rare. It is almost around less than 1%. Intracranial plasmacytomas has been classified by CLAC into three groups. Group 1 is plasmacytoma arising from skull base with multiple cranial nerve palsies, and group 2 is intracranial tumor syndrome, and group 3 is intraorbital tumor syndrome. Neuropathy, it can be peripheral neuropathy or compressive neuropathy. Peripheral neuropathy is usually due to the deposition of antibodies against and myelin deposits, or it can be due to drug-related myelopathy. Cranial nerves, among cranial nerves, 6 nerves is most commonly involved. They are highly chemosensitive and radiosensitive tumors, and plasmacytoma with underlying multiple myeloma has poor prognosis. Multiple myeloma may be included in differential diagnosis of multiple cranial nerve palsy, although ophthalmic signs are rare and generally occur late in the course of disease or as a complication of treatment. Early diagnosis and institution of chemotherapy helps increase the survival rate in such patients. Thank you, and these are my references.
I'll call. Sir. Yeah. Thank you. The next speaker, visual field assessment and rehabilitation of cerebrovascular diseases with established papilloedema. My request is, you go. Unless you became a ratified AAOS member, the marks will not be evaluated. So when you are presenting, always keep make sure that you people become a members also.
So if you are just planning to just in the next year AIOS, so definitely you have to become a member, and before that, because it takes time to get ratified, so definitely you just become a member and get ratified. Because you people are presenting and you have done the work, so definitely you should be there for an award also. But as per the rule, we cannot just give marks to those who are not ratified.
Yes. Yes.
You are ratified. It is written over here that you are not ratified. But she is not presenting now.
that year.
Yeah, that will.
Good morning, everyone. The title of my study is Visual Field Assessment and Rehabilitation in Cerebrovascular Diseases with Established Papilledema. So I have no financial interests. The objective for the study, so cerebrovascular diseases result in functional disability of varying extent. Previous studies have shown that arterial and venous disorders lead to visual derangement. However, these visual disturbances go unnoticed despite having a significant impact during rehabilitation process of these patients. So therefore, our study is aimed at assessing the association and the need of visual field screening in CVD patients with established papilledema. Our study design was a prospective study conducted over 3 years. 28 eyes of 14 patients suffering from CVD were taken. All the newly diagnosed patients were considered, and the exclusion criteria, patients who did not consent or in whom ocular fundus could not be made out due to a dense cataract or hazy media, patients with ocular anomalies, and patients who are old and known cases of CVD. So only newly diagnosed cases we considered, or dense corneal opacity. For the methodology, analysis of the following was done on presentation: a detailed systemic and ocular history, general examination, visual acuity with and without glasses, refraction was done, slit lamp examination and fundus examination was covered. IOP measurement, gonioscopy, visual field assessment, and fundus photography was done. Most commonly, when we come to our results, most commonly the CVD patients belong to the younger age group, with the mean age being 39.07 years. An equal distribution in male and female genders was observed. 72.3% of the patients had acute presentation, whereas 27.7% were chronic sufferers. While venous disorders accounted to 85.7%, with all cases having CVT, arterial disorders were only 14.3%. 71.4%, that is majority, patient presented with a defective vision as a complaint, but 85.7 had visual field abnormalities on examination. However, majority did not suffer from any significant loss in the visual acuity. And there was an association, proven association seen between established papilledema and CVD in the cases. So coming to our discussion, in our study, mean age of patients of CVD was 39 years, which is lesser as compared to the previous studies that are conducted by Roy et al. And Celebesi et al. They are on the higher end. So in our analysis, venous injuries were also common, that is 85%, which is in contrast to the studies done previously, which showed that most of the CVD happen in elderly that are of arterial origin. The reason for this could be that our patients had younger age group as a predominance, and venous diseases are predominant in the younger population. Homonymous hemianopia is the most common type of visual field defect in our study. Also proven the same by Sachov et al. Visual field defects were found in 86% of our patients, despite only 72% patients complained about the visual problem. This is the major point in our study. That is, 14% of the patients did not complain about any vision problem, but were found to have visual field defects when evaluated properly. That means these are the ones which are getting unnoticed. Roy et al. Had a similar observation where visual field defects were 92% and 10% patients did not have any visual complaint. But it is more than the other retrospective studies where the incidence was was around 62 to 71%. Since our prevalence estimates are higher than the other studies, it is indicative of a need for standardized investigation in these patients. So coming to a conclusion, visual field loss is associated with a high risk of falls, and thus it is important to diagnose visual field impairment for these patients who are already compromised. A delay in rehabilitation and functional independence of these patients might lead to optic atrophy and severe derangement of visual field if not taken care of. A proper and mandatory screening of visual fields in CVD patients is quintessential for speedy recovery and is highly recommended. Thank you.
Your good name is?
Rolika.
Yeah, you just showed that your patient, more than 80% they were having CVT. That means cerebral venous sinus thrombosis, no?
Yes, sir.
And what was the field effect?
Sir, field effect was majority was homonymous hemianopia. There was peripheral constriction also observed, sir.
Homonymous hemianopia?
Yes, sir.
What was the fundus finding in all those patients?
Sir,
they were having papilledema or not?
Yes, sir. All of the patients had established papilledema.
And how come this homonymous hemianopia? Where so exactly was the lesion? That was how many eyes? 28
eyes of 14 patients, sir.
So what was the imaging finding? The exact area, these patients, there was infarction or what was that?
So the hemianopia
is not, then there should be an infarction, definitely.
Yes, sir, there will be. So these are on our, like, on ophthalmologic evaluation. So I do not, you mean to say that I should have correlated the MRI finding in the site of thrombus. So I can do that retrospectively even now, but I have not mentioned that over here.
Because we have not seen that homonymous hemianopia. We have seen, I have seen so many patients of day in, day out, I see the established papilledema, marked papilledema is there.
Yes, sir.
That blind spot enlargement and constriction of field is there.
Yes, sir. Constriction field of there was there.
Homonymous hemianopia, it will not come until unless there is a particular lesion at a particular site, optic tract or radiation site, and infarction is there.
Yes,
so definitely then it becomes the findings of the MRI with your study.
You
could have given more weightage to your study and more weightage to your finding.
Okay, sir. So I'll do that retrospectively though. I'll make sure. Thank you, sir.
The next speaker, clinical profile and management outcome of traumatic optic neuropathy, Dr. Satish Sharma. The next one, assessment of visual field defects associated with pituitary adenomas, Dr. Rekha B.K. Mudol.
Good morning. My topic is assessment of visual field defects associated with pituitary adenomas. Coming to the introduction, pituitary adenomas lead to intervisual pathway compression due to supracellular extension resulting in visual field defects. Timely surgical treatment leads to rapid visual function improvement in several cases. Therefore, it's of utmost importance to identify tumors causing visual pathway compression for appropriate early management. The aim of this study is to analyze the different visual field defects and their associations with tumor size at the time of presentation and its effect on prognosis. It's a cross-sectional study consisting of 46 patients. The patients who presented to the neurosurgical unit of our hospital and diagnosed with pituitary adenomas were referred to the ophthalmology OPD. The selected patients were tested for visual field defects using Humphrey's field analyzer along with visual acuity assessment, and different parameters were compared. Coming to the results, the gender distribution, 58% were males and 42% were females. Coming to the different visual field defects, bitemporal hemianopia was seen in around 28%. Peripheral constriction of the field was seen in around 26% of the patients. No visual field defects were seen in 23%. 4.3% showed quadrantanopia, 12.2% showed mixed field defects, and homonymous hemianopia in 6.5%. Coming to the tumor size comparison, 80.43% had a tumor size of greater than 1 centimeter in vertical dimension and 19.5% in less than 1 centimeter. Coming to the discussion, in our study, 52% of the patients were less than 40 years of age. There was a male preponderance with male to female ratio of 1.45:1. 35 patients, that is 76%, showed abnormal visual field defects. Bitemporal hemianopia was the most common presentation, occurring in 13 patients. Peripheral constriction of the field was seen in second most common presentation, which was noted in 12 patients, early detection of which could prevent further loss of visual field. 11 patients out of these had no visual defects. Homonymous hemianopia was observed to have occurred in 3 cases, while 2 presented with quadrantanopia, and mixed field defects were seen in 5 cases. Visual acuity in most of the patients was within normal range. 80.43% patients were diagnosed to have a tumor size of greater than 1 centimeter, while 19.57% patients presented with tumor size less than 1 centimeter. Coming to the conclusion, if early diagnosis of the visual field defects is made, then timely surgical management can hinder in the progression of the defect and deficits can be reversed, ensuring better prognosis. If these tumors go unnoticed, then based on different sites of chiasmal compression, they can cause visual field defect progression, causing poor prognosis. Thank you.
Yeah, you said in one of the slides that visual field was done in selected patient. Because the neurosurgery department, definitely they refer the patient to the ophthalmologist first of all doing a field. But how come this selected patient, you have written in your slide. You can go back to your slide, the first or the second slide, and you have written that it was done in selected patients. Presentation.
Sir, all the patients...
Go on. In material method, I think. Maybe just back.
This one.
Furthermore. One more slide, I think. It was their selected patient, it was written. And you... Next slide.
This one.
You have written this, the selected patients.
Selected patients means the patients who were included in the study, sir, like that.
You have written like this.
Yes.
Because you cannot do selection. Once the neurosurgery department
yes
is referring
sir
to you, you have to do field.
Yes, sir. Means selected patients means whatever patients who have come
those
for
patients who were included
retinoma
in the study.
Yes.
Now, what was the size you just written? 19% were having size less than 1 centimeter.
The vertical dimension, sir, in MRI.
No, that I know.
Yes.
But now the point is, how many patients were there who were not having field effect?
Around 24%, sir, 23%.
Because it is a rule that the pituitary adenoma, it is called microadenoma when it is less than 1 centimeter, that is 10 millimeter.
Yes.
Up till that dimension, it is not going to affect the chiasma.
Yes.
But before, if it is going more than that, that means now the chiasma would be lifted and the
yes
field effect would be there.
Bitemporal was most common, sir.
But the bitemporal was only 28%.
Only 28, sir. And peripheral
it is amazing
constriction
and
was
26%. How come this peripheral constriction in 23%?
Most of the patients we got, sir, which peripheral constriction was seen, sir, in 26%. It was second most common presentation.
This is not, I cannot just digest this thing, because the reason is, again, as I was asking for the other speaker, do you have correlated with the imaging?
Yes, sir, with the MRI, sir, but I couldn't collect the MRI.
Because those patients who were having a peripheral constriction only, what was the size of the tumor? Is more important.
Yes,
was the peripheral that your constriction could not be there. If it is more than 1 centimeter, definitely the bitemporal defect would appear.
Would have been more. In the
case. And the other is homonymous. You have written homonymous. Maybe some certain percentage was there.
Around 6.5%.
So what was the extension of the tumor?
It
was going behind? That
sir
was a paracellar extension going behind?
Prefixed.
Involving the?
Yes, sir, when it was prefixed.
Or the chiasma was prefixed?
Yeah, prefixed, sir. Most of them were prefixed, sir, in homonymous hemianopia.
Okay. So definitely you have to correlate with finding with the
imaging.
Because always ask the patient to bring the imaging with yourself. If you're doing such a study, then it would be more, again, more weightage can be given.
Yes.
Or more authentic, the findings, they can be more authenticated.
Yes.
Fine.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The next speaker, cerebral venous sinus thrombosis manifesting with various ocular conditions. Dr. Chahveer Singh Bindra.
Good morning, everyone. Today I'm going to present my slide on cerebral venous sinus thrombosis manifesting with various ocular conditions. Now, cerebral venous sinus thrombosis is associated with a wide variety of clinical signs and symptoms which may often delay appropriate diagnosis. The most common symptom being headache, 70 to 80%, followed by weakness, hemiparesis, seizures, and peptidema. The clinical patients may present with multiple neurological deficits, neuro-ophthalmological involvement, and altered sensorium. The associated risk factors have been described in the scientific literature as hormone therapy, puerperium, local infections, and many more. Although it can occur at any age, it occurs more frequently between 20 and 40 years and has a higher prevalence in females, with a ratio being 3:1. Due to its variability in clinical manifestation and the rarity of condition, it is difficult to diagnose. The MR venogram and CT venogram is the most commonly used to confirm the diagnosis, and the extent can be seen. Nearly 70 to 80% of all CVSTs are located in the superior sagittal sinus, as was being reported by Bentley et al. The purpose of the present study was to analyze various ocular manifestations associated with cerebral venous sinus thrombosis and importance of MR venogram in early diagnosis. Now, the study is a retrospective phase of 7 patients presenting at our center between 2016 to 2018. Diagnosed with cerebral venous sinus thrombosis on neuroimaging. All patients were treatment naive and presented with neuro-ophthalmological involvement to begin with. They had no history whether they were previously diagnosed with cerebral venous sinus thrombosis. All patients underwent ophthalmic workup, including visual acuity, slit lamp biomicroscopy, and fundus evaluation. The ocular movements were also noted. The presenting systemic symptoms were also analyzed. The patients were diagnosed on the basis of neuroimaging test, including CT scan, MRI or CT or MR venogram. And the location of cerebral venous thrombosis was analyzed. On diagnosing patient with cerebral venous sinus thrombosis, they were analyzed for various ocular manifestation at presentation and the frequency of association with peptidema. Also, the type of involved sinuses was studied and its association with peptidema and sixth nerve involvement in patients presenting initially with neuro-ophthalmological finding were analyzed. Coming to the results, the 7 patients with age ranging from 12 years to 75 years were included. Out of 7 patients, 3 were females and 4 were males. The most common symptom on presentation was headache, which was present in 6 of the 7 cases, while in 2 cases it was associated with vomiting and stiffness of neck. In 1 case, ear discharge was present corresponding to underlying CSOM leading to CVST. Coming to the baseline characteristics, the headache was the most common symptom presenting in 6 cases, followed by fever, vomiting, and neck stiffness and ear discharge. The study showed that the most common symptom was headache, as been already shown, followed by binocular diplopia. In 5 cases, binocular diplopia was due to lateral rectus palsy, secondary to the peptidema, which was there. And bilateral sixth nerve palsy was also seen in 2 cases, while unilateral involvement in 3 cases. The peptidema was seen in 6 cases. Now coming to the sinuses involved, the transverse and the sigmoid sinus were the most commonly involved sinuses in cases presenting with neuro-ophthalmologic symptom as the first symptom. And the sagittal sinus was involved in 2 of the 7 cases. This involvement may be of significance as sigmoid and transverse sinus involvement may be associated with early development of peptidema and sixth nerve involvement. Coming to conclusion, the study revealed that cerebral venous sinus thrombosis can present with neuroophthalmic signs and symptoms as primary manifestation. In such scenario, symptoms ranging from headache, mild blurring of vision, binocular diplopia to vomiting and neck stiffness may be present. Diagnosis is more challenging in hypermetropic patient because in those cases the optic the pseudopeptidema might be a confusing state, and in patients presenting with bilateral optic atrophy, as in such cases, peptidema doesn't occur. And the most common sinuses involved are the sigmoid and transverse sinuses in such cases. Thank you.
So peptidema was present in all cases, no?
So peptidema was seen in all cases. In 2 cases, 1 patient was hypermetropic. So it was, she had a refraction of +3 and +4. So it was confusing, whether it's a pseudopeptidema or not.
So what you did that?
Again, it was confirmed on MR venogram that the patient was having cerebral venous.
No, but you cannot confirm peptidema on MR venogram. Did you do that, this angiography? If you are having confusion with the pseudopeptidema.
Yes, sir, we did the angiography and there were mild leakage. The leakage was not very significant. And in such cases, she was on a very long treatment. She was having a mild dull headache, which was persisting for long. And when we got the MR venogram done, she was confirmed to have cerebral venous sinus thrombosis. She was treated with anticoagulants, heparin, and antibiotics.
So
and
all the patients were treated with anticoagulants and heparin?
Yes, yes.
Okay, no, that pressure gradient along the sinus, you treated the patient or?
No, we didn't treat the, we referred them to the neurologist.
Neurologist, okay. Yes. Did you follow up the patient? No.
The patient did come for follow-up, not all of them, but yes, many of them did come for follow-up and then responded quite well.
You yourself has noted the findings?
Yes, sir.
So what about the transient obscuration of vision? You have not mentioned even a single patient was having, because this is the, I'm just sure that apart from headache, transient obscuration of vision in every study, whatever they are quoted in the literature, it is there. And
sir,
it is a presenting symptom for an ophthalmologist. Headache is not. For headache, the patient will go to neurologist.
Right, sir.
But
right.
For TOV, and the other is tinnitus. Tinnitus you have not mentioned, though it is not a ocular finding.
Sir, the diminution of vision, which was there, actually.
But you have written absent. I was seeing.
Sir, the diminution of vision was absent, but they were having transient obscuration of vision.
That is the important finding.
Yes, that was there.
Because all the study they are showing TOV, that means transient obscuration of vision.
So that was there.
This is how the patient present to an ophthalmologist.
Yes, sir.
And field effects?
Sir, the field effects, we couldn't get it done. Yes, sir.
And vision was almost in every patient?
Sir, in most of the cases, it was around 6669. And in the patient presenting with hypermetropia, the vision was less. It was 618, 624. And then one patient who was presenting with optic atrophy, which was later found out to be cerebral venous sinus thrombosis. That was severe cerebral venous sinus thrombosis. In that, the vision was counting finger, 1 meter.
It was one eye or the other eye also?
So both the eyes.
Both eyes were involved.
Both the eyes were involved.
So how come the patient was coming to, it was a far off patient was coming from far
off?
So
the patient had been under treatment since very long, but was never diagnosed. And the patient followed up at our center. And we got the neuroimaging done, and in that it was found that all the sinuses were involved. It was a grossly involved case.
So just important message for that, because the patient is saying, I don't know, he's saying that that patient was having an optic atrophy. That means it was chronic papilledema was there. And he was treated with, when he came to you with, Dymox?
No, sir. The patient was having decrease in vision. He was having other systemic signs also. He was paralyzed. So the patient was having treatment earlier on. For since 5 to 10 years, he was under treatment. But he was never evaluated for this. He was never treated for this.
So it is a routine practice to do MRV at your center or to refer the patient for MRV?
So when the patient came to us, he was having...
Not for this patient. It's a routine practice for doing MRV?
So not on all on the suspected patients.
What suspected? CVT is there, then you are just...
Right, sir. If you are suspecting CVST or any
not
other...
any other sole, that means intracranial...
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Along with it, MRI, we do normally tell them to get the MRV nogram also done.
So though your presentation is complete, apart from that, I'm just giving a message that he says that one patient came to them with optic atrophy. That means chronic papilledema was there. So definitely that patient was treated for long with Dymox and mannitol and whatever it is, glycerin and Lasix. But definitely MRV is to be done, and refer the patient to a neuroradiologist. They can do, if the facility is there, a pressure gradient. Because the sinus, if the transvenous sinus or the sigmoid sinus is affected, so the pressure proximal and distal to that, so that embolectomy can be done. If that emboli has been formed, thrombosis is there. So there are so many ways to just correct that. That push that patient, what he's talking about, would not have had met the same fate if that patient would have been referred to a neuroradiologist doing a pressure gradient across the sinuses. That is a new thing or established thing, you can say.
So in that case, that patient had been to many ophthalmologists, but he was never diagnosed the same condition. He was never treated
so
for this.
So this is what the message is to that MRV is a must in every patient of papilledema. If space occupying lesion is not there and you are suspecting a superior sagittal sinus or a transverse or a sigmoid sinus thrombosis, then MRV venogram, and with and without contrast both. Because MRV, we don't inject contrast. That is a software. But when we inject contrast, then it becomes a MRV with contrast. Fine.
So one more point which I want to ask you. So have you ever found out, like in the cases coming with neuro-ophthalmological findings in which the sinus is involved, where the sigmoid and transverse are more involved as compared to the sagittal, which has been noted in other cases of cerebral venous sinus thrombosis?
This is a very short, very less number of
yes,
patients.
Yes, this is, but your experience I was asking about, if you
know
have
that,
any.
You know that one sinus is dominant, okay, the transverse sinus. Many a time you would find a hypoplastic transverse sinus. But I may be having a hypoplastic one of my transverse sinus, but the symptomatology is not there.
Not there, right.
So it can be like this. And the literature shows different that your the sinuses are involved with different incidence. So the importance is MRV. And always note that transient obscuration of vision also.
Thank you. The next speaker, role of plasmapheresis in neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorder, Dr. Madhuri Gadde. Thank you all. The session ends.
Yeah, she's not there.
No.
Okay, fine.
No. We have put that. We have mentioned that. Thank you.
Now that they over there, AIC has to take the decision whether.
We have mentioned that.